Welcome, friends, to Magic Duels, the game that I play because there isn't a better magic game to play, and so I'm kind of stuck. Today what we're going to be doing is we're going to go to the store. You can see I have a whole bunch of coin, and my plan had been... Oh, it's jumping the gun here and telling you what my plan is. My plan is to buy Ether Revolt... No? Kaladesh. Sorry. I was going to buy Ether Revolt, but we're going to buy Kaladesh instead. So Kaladesh is most certainly not Zendikar, which is what I keep on saying that we're going to buy. But the thing is that with these being 33% off, because that's the sales price, it's easy for me to pick up the whole of the set and cheaper than I would have had it otherwise. So that's what we're going to be doing. My plan had been, because you can see I'd saved up a lot of money. My plan had been to just buy all of Zendikar and get it over with, but we're going to go and get Kaladesh, which is a big set as far as I remember. But I don't know. We'll see. Anyway, so we're going to buy 32 of these, and we're going to grab about half of the set. As always, this is a terrible... Yes, I'm good with confirming my potion. This is a terrible user interface for opening up packs. And, yeah, open a booster. I'm going to try and tell you a story, since we're opening the wrong pack again. I might have told this story before. There's nothing exciting there. It would have glowed if it was. Long ago and far away, when I got into magic, in fact. Oh, there we go. It's a mythic rare. Menace. When Noxious Gearhawk enters the battlefield, you may destroy another target creature. If a creature is destroyed this way, you gain life equal to its toughness. That's pretty cool, and if you can bounce it. And since it's an artifact, there's ways to do that. You should be alright. When I got into magic, like years and years ago, we were shifting from... I want to say it was 3rd edition into 4th edition. I'm a little fuzzy now. It must have been 3rd edition into 4th edition. And actually 3rd edition was called Revised at that point. And I was told by friends, because I was getting into the game, that what I should do is buy Revised, because Revised had slightly better cards than 4th edition did. To put this into perspective, at that point with Revised, it might have been Unlimited, but Unlimited had a set of dual lands, which were fantastic. And they were like, you should buy boosters of that because you will get the dual land. And I did. My first ever purchase of a magic starter had a dual land. It had a plains mountain. I don't remember what it's called. I think that's Plateau. Anyway, so the point of the story is that just like then, we're opening the wrong boosters, because realistically, if I wanted to play a standard, I should have been buying 4th edition, because they were changing the rules. And again, like the minute I walked into my first tournament, the guy who was running the tournament actually said, you know, your deck is not legal, you should probably buy some Fallen Empires, which was the new thing at that point. The Fallen Empires, as we all know, was terrible. And I bought, I want to say, like 3 or 4 packs of Fallen Empires, and then slopped together a deck and played on a day. But it wasn't a great deck, because I was literally ripping packs and making changes. And so, you know, there's my story of not opening the correct booster again. Yay! Sky Sovereign, console flagship, flying. Whenever Sky Sovereign console flagship enters the battlefield or attacks, it deals 3 damage to target creature or planeswalker an opponent controls. It has crew 3. I'm not crazy about vehicles. I think that they're an interesting design idea, but they're like just okay, and I kind of wish that they weren't in the game, I guess. I'm one of those people who doesn't like that sort of thing. I didn't mind planeswalkers so much, they're just very difficult to come by. This is Angel of Invention. Flying, Vigilance, and Lifelink. That's pretty cool. She's probably not cheap, yeah. And wow, look at those stats. She's 2-1. The budget went to 2 with the wording. Fabricate 2 and other creatures you control gain +1/+1. Her budget went here, which is why she has terrible stats. And this kept on happening, in fact. Like, I would, until I got into the game properly and I understood what I was buying into. People always telling me, buy this, and it was the wrong thing. I didn't buy Homelands, but I dodged that bullet. Like, the only useful thing in Homelands is Merchant's Call. And I never actually collected any Merchant's Calls. I made a point of getting, because at that point in time, every set up until that point had an artifact that would blow up cards printed in that set, and I liked that sort of thing. For those of you old-time players, that would be things like City in a Bottle and that kind of thing, which amused me greatly. I never actually used them. Like, I think the Homelands one was a charm of some sort. Chime. I think it was Apocalypse Chime, if I'm remembering rightly. But basically, the wording on the cards is, it looks and sees if this thing was printed in that set. So, like, for example, if you were playing Arabian Nights, it would look at the symbol on the card, and if it was printed during Arabian Nights, even if it's a different, I believe that the gatherer wording now would be, even if it's from a different printing, as long as it showed up first in Arabian Nights, you can just, like, blow it all up. And I found that hilarious. It was the kind of amusing thing that I enjoy. Okay, so we're going to get 32 more. I am probably going to wind up with, because I think this is a small set. I don't remember. Yeah, that'd be 82. And then I'll pick up the last of those and then have money left over. I am, of course, looking for the Planeswalkers, because they are good. I saw a guy in the lower right-hand corner in that last pack that I don't like at all. Because one of the things that's happened in Magic is that they've made it so that there are some cards that have mechanics on them that give you free creatures, and I'm not crazy about that. Because it circumvents the whole problem of having resources. I mean, why have lands when you can just tap the guy, get into combat, spend energy, which is a resource you can make a lot of, and then get bonus dudes. It circumvents the whole process of, you know, tapping land and making guys. Of course, you put your guy into harm's way, this guy here. Flying at the beginning of your upkeep, you gain blur, and then pay blur, all other creatures are returned to their owner's hands. It's just sigh. I don't know if it's the set or the set just before it, but there's a guy in the set, I think it is, that generates more energy than he spends, and you can use the energy to pick him up, and ugh, do not like. Because in this particular version of the game, there are very few ways to take things off of the table. Okay, so we have Nissa. Oh dear, do we? We've seen Nissa so much. We need to stop that. Anyway, her +1 is untap target land you control until your next turn. It becomes a 5/5 elemental creature with base. Oh, with haste. It's the land. Return target permanent or card from your graveyard to your hand. I like that, and I might actually play that. That's the kind of thing I enjoy. I enjoy recursion. But it's a permanent card, so that makes it less interesting immediately. You get an emblem with blur. Whenever a land enters the battlefield under your control, you may draw a card. Shrug. She is not that interesting. If only her wording hadn't said permanent, I would be a little bit more interested in her and playing her in decks. But I'm a kind of a snob in that respect. I like it to say target card, not target permanent. Because one of the things I do miss greatly about the game is that sort of thoughtful interaction, where in very old Magic, for example, there are lots of cards that interact with the graveyard and allow you to pick things out of the graveyard. And there's still some of that going around, but there's not a lot of it, and when there is, it's very finicky. Like in Nissa's case there, where she's like, oh, I can get you anything out of your graveyard, as long as it's a permanent. I am just not interested. I think it's the next set that has... there's an artifact that I don't recall the name of right now that you can sacrifice to destroy a target permanent, but it costs 1 and the activation cost is 7. Something oil. And that would be great with Nissa. But I like things that exile things, like cards that exile other cards from the game. Because exiling means that you put it so far away that it's very difficult to get. And I don't think I've told the story, but one of my very favorite decks used to do just that. It used to exile everything all the time. So you'd be playing against it and it would like exile your permanents or exile your lands and so on and so forth. Verdurous Gearhulk. Oh, there are 5 Gearhulk as far as I remember. Each one has a different color. When Verdurous Gearhulk enters the battlefield, distribute 4 +1/+1 counters among any number of target creatures you control. Meh. That is incredibly lame. I'm not a fan of combat. For those of you who have been watching me, you will know, or watch me play CCGs, you will know that I'm not a terrific fan of combat. I like decks that do funny things and win. Like I was saying, the whole plan of exiling stuff is fun to me because it puts it so far away that you can't get it again. And the idea that you will draw your library and then not be able to draw is one that I enjoy a lot. I know, I'm a sadist. I made peace with that a long time ago in that respect. I think that is our last booster here. We have to go back to the store and collect more. It's funny, I'm not actually going to see... There we go. 81%, and I'm going to get 15. Oh, that's not too bad. I'm going to end up with 3,000 gold. Yeah, sure. Which maybe sets me on the right path to collecting Zendikar. Oh, there we go. Now we're going to start seeing the Planeswalkers. Suhili Rai, I think I'm saying that correct. This is one that I'm sort of interested in. Scry, Suhili Rai deals 1 damage to each opponent. Actually, no, a lie. Create a token that's a copy of target artifact or creature you control, except it's an artifact in addition to its other types. That token gains haste. Exile it at the beginning of the next end step. Search your library for up to 3 artifact cards with different names. You put them into the battlefield and then shuffle your library. That's kind of none of these excite me. But at least it's not a Gatewatch person. Good lord. Because the Gatewatch are getting a little bit overplayed. In the sense that we see them everywhere doing everything and they're just they're like superheroes, and I am getting a little tired of that. Like, the first time you see them, it's alright, and then the second time you see them, it's sort of alright, and then after that, it just becomes a bit much. Oh, goodness. So, this is my friend, Ether of Kaladesh. I was so going into this thinking, I'm going to be getting all of Ether Revolt. And then look at this. We're getting Kaladesh. Haha! I wonder if those are the only two planeswalkers in this set. If so, that's a little weird, guy. Oh, there we go. This is the other Gearhulk. Combustible Gearhulk. Oh, speaking of the Gearhulks, this game is awkward. It has quests that revolve around you playing one of the Gearhulks. That's the kind of game this is. When Combustible Gearhulk enters the battlefield, target opponent may have you draw three cards. If that player doesn't put the top three cards of your library into your graveyard, then Combustible Gearhulk deals damage to that player equal to the total converted mana cost of those cards. That's pretty okay. But again, in this version of Magic, you only get one, so, eh. One of the things I sort of want to do, once I've got enough of them, is I want to make a deck that is essentially all Mythic Rares. But, you know, the rate of acquisition for Mythic Rares is very, very slow. There we go. Chandra, Torch of Defiance, and you only get one so per deck, so it would be a bit silly. Exile the top card of your library. You may cast that card. If you don't, Chandra... Oh, she's Torch of Defiance, that's right. Deals 2 damage to each opponent. Add 2 red to your mana pool. Chandra, Torch of Defiance, deals 4 damage to target creature. That's not too bad. I wish you could M it at a player, but oh well. You get emblem with whenever you use a spell, whenever you cast a spell, this emblem deals 5 damage to target creature or player. That's not too bad. That's almost worth playing. But it's red, and red is my least favorite color. Red and green are my least favorite colors. Torrential Gearhulk. Flash. That's pretty cool. And he has solid stats. That's a surprise. But he can do that because they're Mythic Rares and people don't expect... Or the Hasbro and Wizards don't expect people to run a lot of Mythic Rares. But they underestimate the player base again. When Torrential Gearhulk enters the battlefield, you may cast target instant card from your graveyard without paying its mana cost. If that card would be put into your graveyard this turn, exile it instead. That's also alright. I am sort of underwhelmed at the Gearhulk cycle. This is my first time seeing them, by the way. Yay, and we get lost. There's really only 3 planeswalkers? Color me confused. Okay, well, let's have a look at this. This is Cataclysmic Gearhulk. I might like this based on name. It's a 4-5. Yeah, it's alright. When Cataclysmic Gearhulk enters the battlefield, each player chooses an artifact. Yeah, I might actually like this. Chooses an artifact, a creature, an enchantment, and a planeswalker from among the non-land permanents he or she controls. Then sacrifices the rest. This is my kind of card. But you can only play one, so it defeats the purpose. Shrug. That's Magic Duels for you, and that's where I'm going to leave this. Anyway, I now have all of Kaladesh. As with all of these sets, this is a free-to-play game. I feel completely underwhelmed when I collect all the sets, all of a set. But what's neat at this point is that I have all of the... No? I definitely don't have that. I have all of Origins, because that was the first thing I ever bought. I have all of Kaladesh, and I think I have all of Innistrad. So, I'm slowly fleshing out my collection. I was going to actually save this gold initially to buy Amonkhet, because I am sort of interested in Amonkhet, but the more I thought about it, because I don't know what this game is going to do, this game might turn into Hearthstone, and it might do a surprise rotation, so I want to collect these guys and Eldritch Moon as fast as I can, so that when and if a rotation occurs, I have all that stuff and I can play, you know, what will they probably call it? They'll probably call it Modern or something. I don't know if this game is going to rotate. Oh, for those of you new to collectible card games, a rotation is where they take some of these cards, like they might take Origins, Zendikar, and Gatewatch, and you can't play them in tournaments going forward that use the standard rule set. Standard rule set might then just include, like, the new stuff. And that's a rotation. I don't like rotations, but that's what they are. Anyway, that's it. That's where I'm going to leave it. Have a great evening, folks. I shall see you all when I have another... I'm going to go... from now on, instead of splitting these videos into two, I'm going to go until I have, like, in the case of Gatewatch, it would be 12,000 gold. In the case of Zendikar, it would be 9,600 gold. And you will see me open a full set, so that's the plan going forward. We will not open bits and pieces, because we know that we can get the whole set all in one go in Magic and Duels. Not like some of the other games where you can't do that. Anyhow, I shall see you all soon. Have a great evening, folks, and good night for now.